Welcome to There's Sometimes a Buggy, Irresponsible Opinions About Classic Film. I'm Elise.
I'm Dave, and this week we return to the Lilli Palmer Acteurist Oeuvre-view. We're into the late 1960s now. We'll be discussing Nobody Runs Forever, also known as The High Commissioner, and Hard Contract. We'll start with Nobody Runs Forever, and we'll hear from Leonard Maltin. He has it under The High Commissioner, and he gives it 1.5 stars out of 4.
Whoa!
Wonderful cast is wasted in tired spy thriller about diplomat involved in murder at height of Cold War negotiations. The director, Ralph Thomas, and the cast list, Christopher Plummer, Rod Taylor, Lilli Palmer, Camilla Sparve, Delia Levy, Clive Reville, and Franco Tone in a special cameo.
Okay, look, I haven't seen many spy thrillers. Probably this one isn't very interesting if you're really into the genre and really want to see what the spy thriller genre can do. I mean, I've seen Hitchcock movies. This wasn't a Hitchcock movie, but the wonderful cast is the reason to watch the movie, and they're not wasted.
No, I don't think they're wasted. I really enjoyed this.
I did too.
I got a little worried about the Lilli Palmer Acteurist Oeuvre-view around the time that we did that double feature of Operation Crossbow and The Miracle of the White Stallions. I felt like those were both lackluster.
You thought that she had jumped the White Stallion?
A little bit, yeah. But she's picking some awesome, weird movies, I think, right now.
These were both big box office failures, by the way.
Well, all the better.
Speaking of Box, Betty Box. This is a Betty Box production.
So she's the Conspiracy of Hearts woman, and also the director is the same, right?
Is it?
Yeah, Ralph Thomas.
Which one was Conspiracy of Hearts again?
The Nuns in Italy.
Oh, yes. Very, very different movie, but also very entertaining.
Yeah.
I'll also say about these two movies that I found interesting before we dive into the first one, linking them together. For me, I mentioned when we did Sebastian how my impression of late 1960s movies were that roles for women were almost uniformly terrible in them. That they were very, very sexist, that there was a lot of objectification.
It may only be in the famous ones and the ones that people went to see.
Yeah, the box office hits, maybe. Because there was none of that in Sebastian and there's none of that in these movies. They are very strikingly feminist in certain ways. And in this movie, Lilli Palmer is again paired with Christopher Plummer as her husband, this time without the excuse of being a classical drama about marrying your mother, because she's 14 years older than him, and she looks older than him, and nobody makes a thing of it in the entire movie.
She does look great.
Of course.
And this movie is so much better than Oedipus Rex.
So much better. Okay, this totally redeemed Christopher Plummer as a movie star for me. He is here doing exactly what Christopher Plummer should be doing. He is underplaying, he's charming, and he's watchable, basically.
He doesn't gouge his eyes out once.
Doesn't need it. Although, this movie also really ends with a bang.
Well, it does. This is an amazing role for Rod Taylor. He's clearly having the time of his life.
He is so much fun. I didn't know that Rod Taylor could be this compelling on screen. I mainly know him from The Birds.
And what about The Time Machine?
Right, and The Time Machine, sure. Not as compelling in either of those movies as he is here with his Aussie accent that he's usually disguising.
Yeah, he's clearly reveling in that. So I guess we should lay out the storyline. Probably nobody that listens to our podcast has ever seen or heard of this movie.
Oh, this is based on a novel by John Cleary, by the way, who also wrote The Sundowners.
Well, that is a terrific movie.
He obviously knows his Australia.
Well, we start out... Well, actually, the first scene is with Christopher Plummer, right? And we see him in his official capacity as the High Commissioner, a delegate from Australia to a world conference that is going to bring about world peace through some kind of wealth redistribution or agreement by the nations of the world to share resources.
So apparently in the novel, the subject was specifically Vietnam. film.
Well, they made it a much more general thing here, where it's about feeding the world's hungry.
Very vague.
After we've seen him on the steps of the big conference, we head south to Australia, where we meet Scobie. Is that his name? Rod Taylor's character?
Yes.
A sort of no-nonsense lawman working in the Northern Territory, unbelievably hot.
Yeah, they were actually showing officers in their uniforms with giant patches of sweat under their armpits.
And he right away makes an impression. This performance is kind of a precursor of some of the better Mel Gibson performances from the 80s. I mean, when he was a good actor.
I had no idea that was going to come out of your mouth. Well, no. he's not as Mel Gibson got famous for playing unhinged characters. He's a very sane character.
Well, that's true.
But yeah, he's just having an unbelievable amount of fun. There's just like a playfulness to him in every scene and a self-deprecation.
I mean, he's making an arrest and he has to knock someone to the ground, but he makes that interaction fun. And then he's summoned to a meeting with the
Premier of New South Wales.
So he's an opponent of Christopher Plummer's character. So you get the sense that this is a conservative asshole who doesn't want anything good to come of this world conference. And he's been at loggerheads for many years with Plummer. And now he's seized his chance because he has found, and it turns out to be true, and this is not a trumped up charge, he has discovered that Christopher Plummer has been living and running for office under an assumed identity, and he had a past life as a man who was accused of killing his wife and then disappearing 18 years ago.
I do not understand how you could rise to this position having changed your identity, but okay.
Well, you can't do it forever. Nobody runs forever, that's the point. I mean, he had a good run. Rod Taylor doesn't want this job. Apparently he's the best man for the job because they know he is going to execute orders even if he doesn't like them. The premier's assistant, I guess, or whoever he is, maybe he's the head of police that Rod Taylor reports to. I'm not 100% clear on all the hierarchical relationships, but that guy is also reluctant to do this. But, you know, there's no way out of this. There is a murder charge hanging over this guy's head, and there's a legitimate reason to bring him back. They don't want to send any of their usual men to do this. There are too many political angles to it, so they just want a guy who's totally outside of all of that, who everyone knows they can trust, and that is Rod Taylor.
And of course, once he arrives in London, in the midst of this international political crowd, he is a fish out of water, and much humor is derived from that, particularly his exchanges with the comical butler.
Yeah, this guy is like a Jeeves. Although, spoilers, as all of our discussions wind up being, sooner or later, and usually sooner rather than later, Joseph is...
He's the source of the leaks.
Yeah, he's involved in a lot of stuff that Jeeves would not be caught dead doing. We don't know what prompted him to do this.
It would be super funny, though, if there was a spy thriller and Jeeves himself was the leak.
Yeah, the dupe of international assassins.
Right off the bat here, where Rod Taylor is trying to arrest Christopher Plummer, and Christopher Plummer's like, no, you don't. You're not going to be able to do this. I'm at least going to be able to win myself a couple of days. Plummer is managing to project all of the authority that I wanted him to have in the role of Oedipus that he did not. He's intimidating, but super charming at the same time.
I mean, it's many other things as well, but it's certainly a buddy movie of sorts.
They hit it off.
Yeah, this is a love story between these two guys, among other things. Scobie, he says he's not interested in politics. He's not going to talk about it. But he clearly feels some pangs of sympathy for the goals of the High Commissioner here.
Oh yeah, the vague goals of world peace. He's on board with that.
And, well, a lot of other people aren't.
And ending poverty. Yeah, and later the Jamaica character gives us a reason for that. Yeah. He says, corruption thrives on chaos. So the crime bosses are the people who do not want a peaceful order to be established.
Right, and capitalists.
Well, he doesn't say that.
He doesn't, but, you know, it's all implied. They're all the same, ultimately. Gangsters and capitalists exploiting third world markets.
Sure.
Scobie eventually comes around to the idea that, well, we can call Canberra, make sure it's okay with them. Let's allow the conference to run its course, see whether Plummer can achieve this lifelong goal or not. before he has to be dragged back to face these charges.
Meanwhile, Lilli Palmer shows up and Christopher Plummer pulls it off. This fellow, I can't remember who he originally says that he is going to be spending the night with them.
There's all kinds of uncertainty and there are issues swirling around this conference, and people begin to assume that either Rod Taylor is an intelligence expert who has been brought in from, you know, the outside to do some quality control on their efforts to contain information, or he's a bodyguard, pure and simple.
Well, he kind of does serve both of those roles.
He does. And his original function.
Christopher Plummer has a pretty young personal secretary.
Yeah, I really liked that actress too. She was good.
Swedish actress. Apparently she starred with James Coburn in Dead Heat on a merry-go-round.
Well, there's a little connection to Hard Contract.
Well, I guess he was just everywhere in the late 60s.
He was, yeah.
The mileage that is gotten out of her, well, she also has a bit of a fun sparring. Everyone has a fun sparring relationship with Rod Taylor. I wondered a bit about, well, is she the source of the leaks? And or are she and Rod Taylor going to become an item? But neither of those things, spoilers, panned out.
Nothing serious comes of the interaction between Rod Taylor and Camilla Sparv. But yeah, I think their scenes together are fun, and who knows, maybe something came out of it afterwards. They're all going to Australia together at the end of the movie, right? Plummer, Taylor, and Sparv.
Yeah, but not in the greatest mood.
Well, no, they've lost Lilli Palmer, and there's a murder charge that I guess he'll be exonerated for in some way or other because of the admissions that Lilli Palmer made. And it's going to become like a ménage à trois, maybe a platonic one. I don't know, everyone's going to be too depressed for sex. But they ask her to come along because Plummer needs her, and Rod Taylor's going to need her too, apparently. That's how it goes out.
Well, right? That's what you were thinking of. That's where you thought this movie was
headed. I don't know. But they both need her. That's what we're told as the movie ends.
Yeah, but there's not any serious suggestion of a romance between her and either of them.
No, there's just too much other stuff going on. I mean, they go on a date to a casino, but that turns out to be a weird misadventure for Rod Taylor.
So, twice, the second time at this casino, Rod Taylor runs into a very memorable character who I've already referred to, Kelvin Lockhart's Jamaica. This actor was so charismatic. Much later in life, he played the electrician in Twin Peaks Fire Walk With Me. Wait, he's also in Wild at Heart.
Yeah, he was really fun in this movie. I was invited, man. That's how he introduces himself to Rod Taylor. But they're both outsiders in one way or another at this conference.
And he was in some blaxploitation films.
He's in Cotton Comes to Harlem?
Yeah.
No, that's good. They do introduce a lot of possibilities, like who could be behind these things, who's sinister, who's a friend. I mean, some of it seems like it's becoming clear and then gets a little misty again. This guy, Jamaica, is almost certainly too likable to be villainous, but you never know. It never quite clears up exactly who he is, but it seems almost certain that he was a CIA guy.
Yeah, well, I think they pretty much imply that, yes.
The U.S. does not admit to that, but they do pay for him to be flown back to be buried, because sadly he is killed in his efforts to stop the assassination.
Yeah, sadly, black guy, first person to be killed in the movie, is operative in this film.
Yeah. And you just don't know who is in cahoots with who, right? Because Camilla Sparv brings him to this casino.
Right.
Jamaica comes out of nowhere and starts talking to him. Did she set that up? And then he gets involved with Maria Cholon, who, again, like, are all three of them working together? Are they all working at cross purposes? It seems like that's more the case. None of them are teamed up with any of the others. She is the one that winds up leaving the party or leaving the casino with Rod Taylor. They have some sex. She actually falls asleep. She seems to have enjoyed it.
Well, that was unfortunate because that's a real slip up for her.
I mean, she is a deeply sinister figure, ultimately, in this movie. She's introduced as kind of a jet-setting friend of the family. She's trusted to recommend a good place to repair your clock when you're staying in London. That was misplaced trust for sure. And she's unmasked fairly quickly after Rod Taylor decides he's not gonna stick around for round two of sex. She really begs him for an encore, but he's got to get back to the High Commissioner.
Just not as charismatic as Christopher Plummer.
No. I didn't find this actress that compelling, although in her sinister aspects, yes. But this just seemed like more of a generic late 60s kind of model actor. I don't know anything about her.
Dahlia Lavi was an Israeli actress, singer, and model.
Yeah, okay.
Freaking load of movies, though.
She plays her role well. She's not supposed to become a front-runner love interest for Scobie. She is just a distraction, and ultimately a very dangerous distraction because she immediately summons her henchmen to kill Scobie, or stop him at least from going back.
Wow, that's a lot of records she made. That might have been her primary career.
So she's got like a real creepy looking henchman guy with a mustache. She hates him because he doesn't come right away when she calls.
That is a little bit fun.
Yeah, it is. And he and his gang go out after Rod Taylor. Taylor is really playing with fire throughout this movie. He's just wandering through London in the middle of the night with dangerous spies. Although I guess this is the first kind of tip-off incident. Or is this after there have been assassination attempts? I think after.
Oh, that's long after this. Yeah, okay. It's a long night.
Yeah, that's right. So we kind of forgot about mentioning that. A bunch of people took some shots at Christopher Plummer and would have killed him if Rod Taylor hadn't noticed.
Christopher Plummer is very reckless in this movie for a guy who wants to accomplish world peace.
Right, well, he doesn't seem to care what happens to him after this conference. But yeah, he should be trying to stay alive at least till the end of the conference.
He's really not. Yeah, so Rod Taylor takes off after these guys. I've got to say, I really enjoyed the fight scenes in this movie. They are...
Yeah, they had weight to them.
They were very brutal. They were very brutal, and they made me cringe and hide my face and worry about Rod Taylor. So
yeah, they had some real crunch to them, and he gets hurt pretty badly a few times, especially in this scene. These four guys attack him in an alleyway. Beautifully shot, that scene, too.
Well, now you're jumping back to after the casino.
Yeah, he seizes upon whatever armaments or armor he can find. He's smashing them with the tops of garbage cans. He's gonna lose eventually here, so...
Oh, they really fuck him up.
Yeah, but he does manage to smash a window, cutting himself with that, too. But it sets off an alarm, brings the police.
Eventually.
In time to prevent them from killing him, anyway. But they kick him pretty hard a few times in the stomach.
Even thinking about it. Oh, some of this is a tribute to the likability of Scobie.
Yeah, Scobie, you really don't want this to be happening to him. Why can't he just hang out with Joseph and Plummer family and Camilla Sparve as Lisa, trading little jokes with them? But no, he's got to get punched and hit and shot at quite a bit in this movie. He's got this sort of running comradely feud with the London police or security people that are supposed to be protecting Christopher Plummer and are doing a terrible job at it. They keep accusing him of holding things back. He's really not. All he's doing is stumbling into more and more dangerous pitfalls of intrigue as he attempts to just wait around for Plummer to finish his assignment. He can't help keeping his eyes open and he notices threats, but that's about it. So they bring him back. Maria Chalon is foiled, as she will be foiled even more thoroughly later on.
Basically, this is it as far as it goes with Rod Taylor's plot. He's just trying to prevent, in several instances, Christopher Plummer from being killed. But let's introduce making jokes with everybody. But let's introduce the Lilli Palmer plot.
Yeah. Well, this ties into the sort of softer side of the Rod Taylor character. He's read the dossier, he's met the people involved now, and he is convinced that Plummer is not guilty, and he doesn't understand why the man ran away. Of course, in the 1950s and 60s, even getting involved in a murder accusation and being exonerated might disqualify you for politics. Now I'm sure it wouldn't.
Oh, now you can become president from jail.
That's obviously part of the matrix there. And we get the sense that there's a lot more going on with this murder. And Lilli Palmer knows about it. And, you know, how much is she responsible
for?
Well,
not only is Rod Taylor a really rugged, amazing bodyguard, he is also a genius detective, because in one brief conversation with Lilli Palmer, he manages to catch her in a lie.
Well, she slips up on the native trees of Perth.
Of course he's like, you know, he knows that like the back of his hand.
I would know trees that don't grow on the East Coast versus the West Coast in Canada, so
I wouldn't know every tree that does that.
Think of it as someone saying, you know, I was enjoying myself sitting under a giant redwood tree in Toronto.
Well, she's a very terrible, like, I mean, you know, this is, I don't understand how they've been able to get away with this for so long.
I mean, they're feeling the pressure right now, and she's cracking, certainly, and we're told that Plummer is not sleeping and is going mental as well, although he's keeping a better handle on himself. Lilli Palmer is going to pieces in this movie.
So I was afraid at first that she wasn't going to get a lot to do, but the first indication that that's not the case is her first big scene with Rod Taylor when she's going through his drawers trying to figure out what he is.
Yeah.
And is begging and begging him to let her know.
Yeah, and she collapses in tears and into his arms, and he's got to comfort her as he deflects her questions. And as she leaves, finally, she's like, you haven't told me anything.
Yeah, I mean, there's just...
It was a great scene.
There's so much more acting going on here than the movie strictly requires, so it was quite impressive.
All lost on Maltin. All of these nuances.
He said the cast was great, but wasted?
Yeah, it's not wasted. No, this was tremendously entertaining and moving. The central problematic here, it boils down to two things. Who is trying to kill, I guess we know Maria Chalon is trying to kill Plummer, although that's not necessarily clear, right? Because even her tool in the house turns out to be Joseph the butler. He thinks that all she's doing is looking for leaks so that they can fuck up Plummer's plan for world peace.
She's kind of like one of those hitmen in Twin Peaks The Return. who have obscure connections to other people who are actually performing the hits.
Yeah, they're doing everything at her bidding, but that's not clear right away. Could be two different things. She might be just trying to get leaks, and she doesn't want Plummer to die because she wants to keep hearing what they're talking about so that they can find ways to screw up the conference without bloodshed, and there might be other people trying to kill him. But no, eventually it becomes clear that it's all the same. The leaks and the assassination attempts are all orchestrated by the same shadowy group. The right hand is not telling the left hand what is going on. And the butler thinks he's just involved in getting leaks, which apparently he can justify, but he certainly can't justify anything when he finds out that they're going to blow up the Plummer house.
Yeah, this was a really sad end for Joseph. I was really hoping that after he did the right thing and told Lilli Palmer what was going on, that he'd brought this clock bomb back into the house unknowingly. I really hoped he'd still be able to get away, but no, he meets his end.
Yeah, stabbed, and one second later, those British security guys come and get the man that stabbed him. Why couldn't they have been a little quicker at their jobs? I don't understand. These guys are really bad. Only Rod Taylor knows what he's doing. This gives Lilli Palmer this amazing opportunity to go out in a blaze of glory.
As it becomes clearer what Rod Taylor is doing there and what's going on, she starts volunteering information, which Christopher Plummer is trying to paint as a false confession about this murder of Plummer's wife. And it's immediately clear that they were having an affair and he was wanting to get a divorce.
What Lilli Palmer says, there's some ellipsis there. She doesn't say she stabbed the wife to death. She just said there was an accident with some scissors. Maybe the wife got up to attack her with the scissors and there was a fight and the wife died. It's not exactly clear. Or the wife killed herself, but it doesn't seem likely. It seems like Lilli Palmer at least was involved in manslaughter, woman slaughter. Plummer was not there even.
Yeah.
That seems to be true, and that's obviously what she put in her final letter that she leaves before she goes off to explode.
The thing is that if she commits suicide. The idea, presumably, is she takes herself out of the way because she'd be a political liability to him?
Yeah, I guess so. Or she feels bad about even inadvertently killing someone. That sort of makes sense.
When she takes the clock to Maria to blow them both up, she says something about how Christopher Plummer would never even think about killing anyone. So that made me wonder, like, obviously she's talking about she did think about it. That made me wonder if maybe she did do it on purpose and that's why she's so guilty. And if that came out,
yeah,
then she would ruin his political career.
That's the impression that the whole thing leaves you with, although it's never 100% stated.
Right, because then Plummer afterwards says, and you don't know whether he knows or not, or whether we're supposed to trust him as viewers, because he then says to Rod Taylor at the end, she was telling the truth, it was an accident, but he wasn't there.
No.
They're very believable in this movie. As a very devoted couple.
Yeah, absolutely. And tortured. At least Lilli Palmer is. Christopher Plummer is so idealistic that he is not really seeing all of the details of this tragedy that had unfolded in the past. But yeah, Lilli Palmer's been bearing most of that for both of them, it seems like. And the weight of it is way too much. We get a bit of the hard as nails Lilli Palmer, right? Where she talks about, yeah, I'm willing to get down there and kill the people that need to be killed. Like his first wife and like the international terrorists and assassins and gangsters and capitalists that are trying to foil this conference. And she certainly does so. So hopefully Maria Shalon was a real kingpin in that movement because, yeah, she's no more at the end of this movie. And that's all Lilli Palmer's doing. Maybe she would have gotten away without this bomb. And she just derives a lot of sad glee from revealing to her, hey, look, here's the clock. Recognize this? She doesn't have to do that. She could just let it go off. But no, she wants Maria Shalon to know. It's like a Bond villain speech, but we're on her side, right? She's the good guy. Although a very compromised good guy.
Yeah, absolutely.
So yeah, a great role for Lilli Palmer. I mean, she's getting billed third in everything, and that seems to be inevitable based on the way casting works.
Sure, but she's definitely, even though she keeps going to these box office flops, she's established character actress.
Oh yeah, I feel like this was the right move for all of these performers, and it's just a real shame that the audience was wrong. Let's proceed to Leonard Maltin's views on Hard Contract from 1969. He gives this one 2.5 stars.
What did he give the other one? Oh, 1.5.
Yeah. Hired killer Coburn starts to have self-doubts when a woman, Lee Remick, humanizes him. Film is too concerned with making an important statement to become particularly entertaining or involving. Director S. Lee Pogostin and the cast list, James Coburn, Lee Remick, Lilli Palmer, Burgess Meredith, Patrick McGee, Sterling Hayden, and Karen Black.
Yeah, so I don't agree. I mean, I guess if anybody came to this movie expecting a James Coburn movie, which apparently James Coburn himself did, like he signed up for this project, it seems, from his statements repudiating it, he seemed to have signed up for this project expecting that he was in an action movie. I don't know how, but he was very unhappy with this first-time director, didn't think he knew what he was doing, and blamed that for the box office failure. This movie apparently, at least according to the Wikipedia budget given here, had a far larger budget than High Commissioner.
Right, well, it's a US movie. High Commissioner was a UK movie. And it lost a lot of money, it looks like. Because the box office was 2.3 million off from the budget.
Yes, but I don't know how anybody could read this script, which apparently is the basis on which this writer sold the movie to the producer, pitched a script, and insisted on directing it. I don't know how anyone could look at this script and think it was commercial. Like, this is one of the most original movies I have ever seen, and probably the most enjoyable, weird, quirky little movie we've watched for the podcast since Ever Smile, New Jersey.
It was amazing. As great as, I mean, I really enjoyed Nobody Runs Forever, but yeah, this one was even more remarkable, I thought.
Absolutely original.
It has to have been an inspiration for Gross Point Blank, which we'll be talking about one day on the podcast.
So this writer. He wrote for television a lot. He seems to have made... he seems to have worked in garbage genres a lot.
So this was his one bid to make art.
Science fiction and something called Nightmare Honeymoon, described as sadistic low-budget thriller, among some other things. But yes, obviously this was his passion project, and he managed to pitch it, and he managed to get James Coburn. And I mean, you know, it got out into the world, and a few people have seen it, and it's great.
I loved it. James Coburn was amazing in this movie. It's like a Spock performance, right? Spock thawing and falling in love. And...
Well, if Spock was a hitman.
Yeah, exactly. He even looks like Leonard Nimoy a bit.
A bit. I don't, like, wow, tastes have changed. And I guess James Coburn was a thing of the moment. The way Alan Ladd was a thing of the moment, and I can understand Alan Ladd better than I can understand this man being a sex god.
Well, James Coburn, Lee Marvin, you know, these are the guys that were dominating a certain part of the Hollywood scene in the 60s.
But did women really think they were sexy, or is it just men who went to the movies and thought that women must think this kind of man is sexy? I'm not sure.
I guess Steve McQueen is sort of the ultimate of those guys.
By the way, do you know who at the time thought this movie was a masterpiece and wrote an essayistic review of it?
I couldn't imagine.
Harlan Ellison.
Well, it is. I mean, it completely took me by surprise. I had no idea what we were gonna get here. I thought it was gonna be just your standard hard-ass late 60s action movie, and I guess it starred as well, but it turned out to be something so much more interesting.
It's just a philosophical movie, but it's a philosophical movie populated by completely eccentric characters. So the hitman, yeah, I mean, one way you could describe the movie is as a hitman falls in love, but he falls in love with, like, speaking of jet setters, a group of, well, a woman who is part of a group of wealthy, neurotic, ennui-stricken expats.
Post-Nazis.
Well, he's one of the people hanging around.
Yeah.
And she is this weirdo woman played wonderfully by Lee Remick.
Oh, she's so great.
Who also looks fantastic, of course. We learn that she has had several husbands and...
has never had an orgasm.
And several psychiatrists. Yes, but that's not how Lilli Palmer puts it. We just hear over and over and over again about the miracle that has taken place.
What a strange but a wonderful plot point.
The terms of the movie's discussion are murder, including genocide and, you know, all sorts of types of killing taking place on a grand scale because of war, genocide, and...
the Cold War.
And the Cold War and poverty, right? All of these mass murders with which we are all familiar now through media. So that's one of the terms of the movie, murder. Another term is religion, God, and another term is love. And they are all brought together in just these absolutely quirky, meandering, unexpected ways. You know, it's just a movie of ideas.
Yeah, and when James Coburn read the script, possibly he imagined that, okay, he kills several people in this movie. He must have thought we were actually going to see him do it, right? That might have been left unclear, but the director had no intention of showing him do any of that stuff. We just see the effects. We see him sidle into a movie theater next to his intended victim, and a little while later, the guy's dead.
Sure, but it's very important that what's playing in the movie theater is...
newsreels.
Is newsreels about famine-stricken African country where a man is talking about, you know, telling a Western interviewer all about their problems, that they have famine, poverty, disease, no hospitals, no vaccines, just conveying this low-level urgent distress, but that at the same time he doesn't seem to really have any hope.
No, he's like, you know, we'll take whatever you can send us. Please send us all of these things. I've got a long list.
Yeah.
But obviously not nearly enough is going to come forth to save most of the people in his care.
And meanwhile, James Coburn and his victim are sitting there chewing on candy bars.
Yeah. And one of them's going to be dead soon. And Coburn goes about his life. Early on, he goes to meet up with his contact, Burgess Meredith. and their discussions are very enjoyable.
Yeah, and he is some kind of professor, some kind of intellectual.
Well, I guess that's part of what he does. Yeah, he's a mathematician. We learn that he was involved to the hilt in the Spanish Civil War, and when Madrid fell, basically he gave up on having any ideals, and that's why he is the finger man for James Coburn's victims now. We don't really know exactly who they're working for, but it seems to be some kind of government operation, a black ops kind of thing.
I didn't really give it any thought why they were doing this.
No, it's not emphasized by the film.
But Sterling Hayden eventually shows up as a victim, but he is also a former hitman.
Yeah, well, that's why they intend to kill him, because they can't leave him alive because he knows too much, clearly.
Right.
He hasn't been doing anything else, so it must be for that, right? If you try to leave, then you have to be killed because you're not part of the team anymore.
Well, yes, that's explicitly, that's kind of the problem.
Yeah.
At the end of the movie. But in the meantime, we do have an interaction between Coburn and a prostitute.
That's Karen Black.
I guess I should say sex worker.
She was really fun.
She was very fun. And I mean, she sort of establishes the sexual features and problems of Coburn's character. He's a very, very satisfying lover, but
will not kiss anyone or fall asleep next to anyone.
Yeah, obviously he has strict limitations on his emotional involvement.
And he votes the straight Republican ticket, which she chastises him for.
You know, as we see more and more of him, obviously, we realize that he's a walking metaphor in which his ability to love is in inverse proportion to his ability to be a hitman. The hitman component, well, it's hard to say whether that is part of his effectiveness as a lover, but maybe not, because even once he's thinking of giving it up, he seems to still be good at that. So
yeah.
Probably not. But he's dissociated sex from emotion. But the movie keeps on playing with this idea of love, like, even though it's going to ultimately assert, it's the essay here is going to ultimately argue that love is stronger than death, and love is the thing that you need to embrace if you're going to get past this destructive nihilism. It nevertheless questions that thoroughly throughout the movies, particularly using the figure of this ex-Nazi.
Yeah.
Right? Where Remick is going on about, he can love. He can love. He probably made his fortune off of people's teeth.
Yeah.
And we are to believe that, yes, it's true. Like, anybody, even a monster, can fall in love. So what does love actually mean?
Well, it's not necessarily ennobling, that's for sure. It has a power, and it can change the entire course of your life one way or the other.
Lee Remick is kind of a maniac.
Oh, very much so.
So she, in order to pick up James Coburn, who has gone off to Europe for the first time in his life, it's almost a Henry James plot.
That's why he accepts the hard contract, because Burgess Meredith lays it all out. He's like, I don't know if you're gonna like this one, because we got one guy over here, got one guy over there, and the other guy, we don't even know where he is yet. You're not going to be able to prepare for it the way you like to. But yeah, Coburn thinks it over and he says, okay, well, yeah, I don't like this kind of contract usually, but Europe? Sure. I need to see that.
Right. So when he runs across this group of grotesques,
he shows up at the hotel bar in Spain and he just says, where do I buy a woman around here? And these jet setters overhear it, and it becomes the talk of their group. They're like, what is he talking about? You don't have to buy anyone here. Anyone will sleep with you for free.
Right, and he's also cheap. He's only willing to pay 50 bucks. But anyway, Lee Remick, in order to pick this guy up,
just so intrigued by him that she poses as...
I think she's more horny than intrigued.
It's all the same thing. She poses as a sex worker, yes. And she sidles up to him and she tries out this, it's like Belle du Jour a little bit. But with a real strange guy on the other side, too. One of the strangest love stories ever begins.
So she has her miracle.
I thought there was something wrong with the transfer or something, but I think it really was supposed to look like that. Like that, it looked like the film froze.
Yeah, they freeze frame on her orgasm.
Yeah, it was pretty amazing. It's pretty clear after you get through the initial confusion that that's what's happened. Something completely unexpected has occurred in
time,
the sack.
Time stops. So yes, but beyond that, she decides she is so intrigued by him that she wants to have him followed.
Oh yeah, and she's got the perfect comrades to make sure that that happens. Ex-Nazis who know all kinds of shady personnel all throughout Europe. She just drops this request to her Nazi boyfriend and he's like, yeah, no problem, we'll make sure. This guy is so weird. Everyone is so weird in this group. Obviously, Lilli Palmer, the most vocal member of the group. She gets a lot of mileage out of her girl talk with Lee Remick.
Yeah, it really felt to me that if not for her German accent, she would have been a great candidate to play Jane Bowles. Speaking of wacky, decadent American expats. But she is supposed to be British in this movie. Do you think that, we're supposed to believe she's actually British?
She says she's, you know, no one has a kind word for rich, white, Anglo-Saxon Protestants.
I mean, it's very, the movie has to acknowledge, has to know that it's very jarring to hear Lilli Palmer say that in her German accent.
Yeah, well, it's part of the joke, I think, right? Yeah. But no, she's certainly supposed to be that, but we know who Lilli Palmer is, and that's why we can enjoy it so much. It would be a little bit creepier if it was an actual wasp talking like that on screen. And palling around with Nazis.
But her character is very, very daffy, but also very, very innocent. She finds it impossible to believe, and this is another one of the movie's little philosophical twists. She finds it impossible to believe that this man is a Nazi, Alexei, because he's so nice.
Yeah, she's like, well, he did go to jail for several years, and everyone says that he was in charge of a death camp, but I don't think that's true.
So she has the kind of innocence that is immoral.
Yeah.
Like a stupid innocence.
A very dangerous kind of innocence.
Moral stupidity. Oh, by the way, Alexei is played by Patrick George McGee, a Northern Irish actor who was noted for his collaborations with Samuel Beckett and Harold Pinter, sometimes called Beckett's favorite actor. Where did they get this cast? This is insane.
I think most of the people who were involved understood that this was going to be some kind of a cult classic.
Just not James Coburn, but they couldn't have made it without him. And also they needed this persona. And as you say, it's also a great performance.
It is. I haven't seen a lot of James Coburn movies, but I can't imagine he gave many greater performances than this. And if he gave it without understanding what he was doing, all the better.
So what's fascinating is that as their relationship develops, he falls in love with her because she is so interesting. He's really, really interested in her thoughts. Like, yeah. Where he finally goes completely overboard to the point where he's frightened is when they're having that conversation about her thoughts about God and whether or not God exists.
Yeah, he exists for seconds or moments at a time. And then he doesn't exist, and then he does exist. It's flickering on and off constantly. That's her spiritual life.
And James Coburn is just so, so, so intrigued. And he really plays the emotions so well.
He does. Thought he was going to be a sticking point for me. Like, am I going to love a movie with James Coburn at the center of it? But yeah, absolutely.
And he's also really good at the comedy. Like when he is trying to get her out of his system and he keeps telling Burgess Meredith, this is just, it's an amateur country. Amateur continent. It's just an amateur place. Everything's amateur.
Oh yeah, there are some really fun moments with him and Burgess Meredith. Burgess gets really worried and comes across the Atlantic, which is, again, not part of the way they operate. And James Coburn has a very particular style as a hitman. He's a sole operator. He gets the dossier from his contact and that's it. No further discussion. Now Burgess Meredith shows up and poses as a pal in from the USA. He meets this weird gang and strange romance develops between Burgess Meredith and Lilli Palmer. that seems like it's going to end happily as well. I mean, the movie is just full of all kinds of happy endings here. And Sterling Hayden, what can you say? The man is wonderful. And he was really picking his spots in the late 60s and 70s. I mean, just this and The Long Goodbye, just those alone would put him in the Hall of Fame. And those aren't even movies he starred in.
Well, on Letterboxd, everybody either loves this movie like we did, or just like, my God, this was boring. But a lot of people talk about Sterling Hayden as the highlight of the movie. I don't know, like, there were so many highlights.
Yeah.
That I don't know if I need that to be the case. But yes, so he does have a very long, important talk with James Coburn about what it means to give up murdering.
Yeah, they're just talking it over in this rustic setting in Spain outside of Madrid. And of course, this is Franco's Spain, right? Fascist Spain, all of this is taking place in. Which Lee Remick alludes to, right? When she finds out that Coburn is a hitman, she wants to know what ideology motivates him, who he's working for.
She just wants him to be doing it for some reason. She says, fine, whatever reason, as long as you believe in that reason, I will get behind you, but just don't tell me you're just doing it to do it.
Yeah, but he's very honest with her, and he's like, there's nothing. And she's like, she's very disappointed at first, and then she's like, oh, I get it. You still can't tell me because it's such an important secret. Well, don't worry. I'll help you no matter who you're working for, but I really hope you're here to fuck up these fascists.
Right. So there's also a long dialogue between Burgess Meredith and Lilli Palmer in front of the Goya painting.
Execution or...
Yes, it's the Napoleon's forces in Spain.
Yeah, the Iberian, the Peninsular Campaign, which had kind of the characteristics of a civil war because, Spain was just a battleground for 6 years, right? And you have insurgents and...
And this is where he starts going on about how murder has changed. I think this is the second time he makes a speech like this about how murder is different now, and it's not quite as immoral as it used to be because it's on a mass scale that everybody is aware of.
And it's still wrong, but it's just not that wrong.
And Lilli Palmer, in her innocent stupidity, keeps going, oh, but he can't be serious. He can't be serious. It's still wrong, isn't it? And then Lee Remick comes in and says, yes, but it's just not as wrong.
It was amazing. I don't understand how this guy came up with this script.
I don't know. James Coburn claimed that they directed themselves. Who knows? But the comedy, like, everybody is delivering the script exactly as it should be delivered.
Yeah, well, they're all brilliant actors. Like, all of them. I guess that helps. But yeah, the script is there, and it is amazing. It's such a great way of zeroing in on this malaise of the late 20th century that everyone sort of understands, but without really being able to characterize in hard details. I mean, and these guys don't do it, just the sense that it's not like there are no values anymore. That's not true, but everything's just become a little gauzier. Everything just is in danger of being public relations.
Rather than something morally impactful such as you might want to get from a religious worldview. Having established that in the grand scheme of things now, with all of this weight of knowledge that we have of all of the murder, having established that, you know, just killing off a few random people just can't feel like that much of a crime, the movie then switches to trying to make us again feel the weight of committing murder. And that is what the interaction between James Coburn and Sterling Hayden is about.
Yeah, he gave up the hitman profession 15 years ago and started reading books. And just every day that passed that he didn't do it, it slowly became his new life. That he just doesn't kill. And now he says, although he's worried about being tested on this, that he won't kill for any reason anymore.
Not even if his wife is threatened, not even if his grandchildren are threatened. James Coburn has a crisis because he doesn't know how to get out of this without killing somebody, and he doesn't want to kill anybody anymore, and he particularly doesn't want to kill Sterling Hayden. So his way to get out of this crisis is to consider killing everybody.
Yeah, well, he would have to, right? If he was going to go on with this life, he would have to kill all of these people because they all basically know that he's a hitman, or they're pretty clear on it.
But how does he know he wouldn't also die in this accident?
Well, he doesn't.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And this causes a little bit of...
I mean, that was a tense scene.
It was a very tense scene. And it causes a little bit of a conflict between Lee Remick and him as she realizes that she was thinking of killing her.
Well, she does know too much. And it becomes sort of a dark, blazing noon of the soul, because it's all happening in the harsh Spanish sun. When he slows the car down, that's it. He's through with murder forever. And somehow, I mean, and this movie is invested in the idea that a decision like that deserves a totally different ending than the nihilistic one you'd been expecting.
Yeah, and having interrogated the concept of love, it basically just resolves with the idea that it's our only hope. Whatever it is, it's our only hope, right? So yep. Everyone's going to fall in love now.
Drive off together and change your identity. Live in the South Pacific or something, and nobody's going to find you, hopefully.
And then our final scene is Lee Remick and James Coburn going off into the bushes to have sex while she again demands that he pretend that he's doing this for some reason, so he tells her as part of his...
Love talk, pillow talk,
but they don't have any pillows, that he's going to save the world from communism.
You know, any kind of ideology is good enough for her. Just let's get rid of this void of nihilism that's threatening to engulf us all. You know, that's a valid point of view, I suppose. Truly wonderful. We'll see. When we watch Gross Point Blank, I'll remind you of this viewing experience and we'll talk about it again at that time. I don't know if you'll like it as much as this.
So yeah, after the unfortunate blip of The Miracle of the White Stallions in particular.
Well, I thought Operation Crossbow sucked.
Okay. Well, they were both bad.
Except for Sophia Loren and Lilli Palmer in that scene.
Yeah, she did have a really good scene in that. Other than that episode, well, we're back to, I guess, a point we made earlier, which is that one of the hallmarks of Palmer's career, or let's say one of her hallmarks as an acteur after she was able to choose her roles, is that she makes such interesting choices. And I was really dreading, as you know, Dave, I was really dreading doing this series because there are so many movies in it, and that was not part of our original idea of the acteur series. But I mean, it's quite remarkable to find somebody who is doing that over and over and over again in a long career with many movies, is choosing such interesting projects, because that's definitely a hallmark of the actors we started out with, people like Jennifer Jones and Daniel Day-Lewis, but these are people so selective and big enough stars that they don't have to have a huge crowded filmography, right? So it's interesting that she, Lilli Palmer, seems to keep finding or ending up in these somewhat unusual little movies, right? Or in some unusual big movies, too.
Happy you've come around completely, it sounds like, to the greatness of Lilli Palmer.
But we may be tested in our next Lilli Palmer episode.
Well, that's Desaad and The House That Screamed. These are going to be somewhere on the horror scale.
We're really not people for 70s erotic or gore horror. So if that is, in fact, what these movies are going to be like, yeah, I don't know. It's not the sort of thing we're normally into, but who knows?
Never know. They may surprise us. I hope they do. But next week, on the podcast, it's the Hollywood Studios Year by Year, MGM 1947. We'll be discussing Cynthia and High Wall, two very disparate films.